Duralde's mission is a virtual reality experience in which the player takes the role of an astronaut that has an important mission: test the first ship capable of jumping through hyperspace. An operator helps the player complete the mission by running them through procedures and solving eventual problems. Our goal was to explore immersion and communication in a way unique to VR as a medium. We wanted to contrast the isolating experience of being alone in space with the social element of having someone as mission control supporting them over their headset. For many people, virtual reality and gaming are seen as isolating and antisocial activities. We feel that the most meaningful virtual reality experiences will be those that have a social element, so we wanted to put focus on this aspect. Taking the players out of a known and familiar place allowed us to focus on designing an environment that was optimal for VR. We designed our spaceship controls, audio, and other sensory aspects of the experience from the ground up for this medium, rather than trying to mimic something from real life.
Hello, astronaut, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so this, as you know, is the first made mission. How is life support doing?
Life support is 100%, breathable air 90%, oxygen recycler nominal.
Now the hyperdrive should be timed. You should be able to press the button on the top to go into hyperdrive. I'll talk to you on the other side. Good luck.
Developing for VR is very different than for a traditional screen. Rather than relying on well-known best practices, we had to build and user test constantly in an agile fashion. However, a few core theories of what others have found compelling in VR helped guide our design iterations, namely proto-presence, sensory immersion, and social presence. Proto-presence is achieved when there's a sense of embodiment, a clear distinction between the body and the world. In particular, when a VR experience is able to give players a consistent sense of virtual body. We added a virtual hand and joystick that mirrors the motion our players make with the physical joystick they're using for control. We also used the rotational and positional tracking the Oculus headset provides to animate the virtual body and head of the player. This would allow the body and shadows to mirror all of the subtle movements players naturally make that would normally be lost when interacting as a virtual character. To have solid tracking, we also spent the time to heavily optimize our application to get a steady 75 frames per second. This is a vital aspect, not only important for providing users with smooth tracking, but also for avoiding the motion sickness and strain that poorly built virtual reality experiences can cause for users. For sensory immersion, we focused on scoping out a small environment that allowed us to spend the bulk of our energy producing a few high-quality assets, rather than worry about the breadth of content we needed to produce. Audio is an often overlooked but important aspect of sensory immersion. Our experience featured 3D spatial audio to give the players a better sense of their surroundings. Finally, we use the subwoofer in our physical rig to mimic the sound and rumble of the ship as it made hyperspace jumps. The choice to have a live operator allowed us to focus on other aspects of immersion, such as the social, challenge, and imaginative elements. Through the role of the operator, we were able to adapt to each player and co-construct the shared narrative.
I think what was especially interesting to me was the blend of real-world and virtual-world experience going into a space like that. The level of the technical achievement, the game itself, you know, there was no nausea, there was no latency, the visuals were good, the idea of the red dot that follows your gaze was really well done. And little things, you know, which are, you don't realize until you see them, but look down, you see your shoulder, you look down, you see, or they seem to be your legs, you know, with the space boots and everything like that. Those were all really good.
On our first playtest session, the players needed to point their heads towards a button to select it. However, we found that people were having trouble using the interface. On a later iteration, we added a red dot that follows the direction that the player is facing, and the interaction became way smoother. From that point, we built a skeleton of the experience, with only basic shapes and no textures. That allowed us to evolve the experience in cycles of research, implementation, and testing. By iterating, we quickly found and solved problems, only settling on the script and moving it to a more realistic art level once we were confident with the prototype. We thank you for flying with CMD,